In this lecture, we'll see what more we can learn from observations of exoplanets. The basis for all this, of course, is Newton's laws of gravity and Kepler's laws of planetary motion. These describe the motions of planets in our solar system. That's how Kepler's laws were derived. But they also apply equally to planets in other star systems until all the exoplanets discovered. The first law of planet motion from Kepler is that planets move in elliptical orbits with a star located at one focus of the ellipse. As we've seen, exoplanets on average tend to have larger ellipticities or more elliptical or squashed orbits than the planets in the solar system, which are mostly quite close to circular. Kepler's second law of planetary motion is that the line connecting a planet and the star sweeps out equal areas in equal times as the planet moves through its orbit. And the third law is a mathematical relationship between the period of the planet and the semi-major axis or mean distance of the planet from the star, such that the cube of the period of the planet is proportional to the square of the semi-major axis. This, of course, refers to the fact that the most distant planets in our solar system and all others are moving more slowly in their orbits and so have longer periods. Kepler's third law, in particular, is the time a planet takes to complete an orbit. And this is very relevant, of course, because all the observations of exoplanets are keyed in terms of how much data you need to measure a planet orbit of a particular amount. So while the detection of planets is keying to physical properties, such as mass and size, the observational situation is often determined by the period of the orbit. In general, smaller period orbits, shorter orbits, or nearby to the star, are much easier to detect and quicker to detect than long period orbits. Radial velocity method gives us two pieces of information. It's the stellar velocity over time, and that's the map we see here, the situation of 51 peg that we've seen before. Using radial velocity data and invoking Kepler's laws, we can learn some things about the star exoplanet system. By invoking the first law, we claim the point in the data where the cycle begins to repeat is the point where the star and the planet have each completed an orbit about their common center of gravity. And so in this situation, using the discovery data of 51 peg, we can use Kepler's third law to calculate the orbital distance of 51 peg b planet based on its orbital period of 4.4 days. And so the answer that comes out of this calculation is 1/20th of an astronomical unit, 0.05 astronomical units, or 20 times closer to the star than the Earth is to the Sun. This is the equivalent of having a planet half the size of Jupiter orbiting the Sun every 4.5 days, well inside the orbit of Mercury. Using the orbital distance and the implications of the first law, we can calculate the velocity of the exoplanet. Remember, it's a spectral measurement that we're making, but that spectral measurement of a velocity shift or a Doppler shift can be converted directly into a physical velocity or a radial velocity in space. And we can see how the star is orbiting because we know the orbital period, we know the distance the star has to travel in the orbital period, and therefore we can see how fast and how far the star is moving, or the planet is moving in its orbit of the star. Just taking the distance of the orbit and the orbital period and converting days to seconds and astronomical units to kilometers, we come up with a velocity in the orbit of 128 kilometers per second. And so for this, the first planet discovered beyond the solar system, we have an orbital period of 4.4 days and a velocity in its orbit of 130 kilometers per second. What fraction of that 130 kilometers per second we see depends on where it is in its orbit. Once the velocity of the planet is known, we can calculate the exoplanet mass in this way. So the observational velocity of the star, the mean velocity of the star in its orbital period is 55 kilometers per second. The total velocity, as we've seen, is closer to 130 kilometers per second. Plugging this into the gravity equation gives a mass of half a Jupiter mass. And so this is the calculation that's done in all exoplanets studied with the radial velocity technique to measure their mass. What about the size of the planet? Here we use the information provided by the transit method to calculate the physical size of the transit. It's quite simple, because the transit depth measures how much of the star's light is dimmed during the transit, and larger planets block more starlight. So the transit depth is clearly related to the ratio of the area of the planet to the area of the star. Now, in measuring the area of the star, we have an interesting situation, because the area of the star, or the size of the star, is not actually measured in this observation. We assume what the star area is based on our knowledge of the star type. So there are a set of extra assumptions that go into understanding what the star area is, since it's not exactly observed. Basically, spectroscopy of the star and its distance is used to assign a luminosity, and its evolutionary state plus its luminosity plus its spectral type can be used to infer from stellar models a stellar radius, and that gives the cross-sectional area. Knowing the size allows us to calculate the density of the planet. Density is mass divided by volume. We have the mass from the radial velocity technique, as previously described, and we have the size of the planet, or this cross-sectional area, from the transit method. And that, assuming a mean density, allows us to get the volume. So density of the exoplanet is a key to understanding its composition. It's, of course, a mean density. And since planets are differentiated and are likely to have denser cores and less dense outer regions and be surrounded by even lower density atmospheres, clearly one single mean density is an inappropriate characterization of an exoplanet, which is more complex in its radial structure. But at least it's a benchmark that could allow us to distinguish between primarily a gassy object like Jupiter, primarily a rocky object like the Earth, and perhaps one that might be metallic and even higher density. Given this information, the radial velocity curve and the transit curve, we've learned some important things about exoplanets and taken the next step along the road to characterize them in the zoo of possible planetary configurations. We've seen that we can combine information and use the physical characteristics of an orbit and Newton's laws and Kepler's laws of motion to understand more detail about the planet. Starting with observations of the radial velocity curve, we can move towards the orbital period and then towards the mass of the planet based on the radial velocity amplitude. From the transit data, we can move towards from the depth of the transit and the eclipse to the cross-sectional area of the planet, and with an assumption about the stellar type to give us the cross-sectional area of the star, we can get the size of the exoplanet, thereby its volume. Combining these two pieces of information gives a mean density, which is our first hint as to the fundamental nature of the exoplanet.